Good afternoon. I am Clara Ross Stamps, and I have the honor of serving as your Senior Vice President for Brand Identity and University Relations. And today I will be serving as your program guide. For this day, that Kentucky State University, it is this day, 135 years ago, we were founded, and we will rejoice and be glad about it. This is a great day to gather at the college on the hill and to celebrate and remember those who came before us. We honor them by advancing onward and upward and by always uplifting our beloved Kentucky State University. Thank you for celebrating with us today. We will proceed with the program as printed. Thank you, Mr. Rafford, for our prelude. We will now have a welcome by Dr. Elaine Ferris, the chairperson of the Kentucky State University Board of Regents. She will be followed by a special presentation by Representative Derek Graham of the class of 1980. He will be followed by a musical selection by our class member, Angela Brichette, a renowned singer and actress. That will be followed by the occasion by Dr. William H. Turner, interim director of the Creed Center. We will proceed with the program as printed. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us today in person and virtually for this historic moment at the College on the Hill. Today, we welcome our panelists, Kentucky State University President M. Christopher Brown II, our former presidents, Dr. Mary S. Evans Sias and Raymond Burse, and author Dr. John A. Hardin, and members of our Board of Regents, and our elected officials and distinguished guests. Kentucky State University was chartered 135 years ago in May 1886 by the state legislature. Now, in May 2021, we look back at the lives changed and the access to education provided by Kentucky State University. As stewards of this great institution, may we always remember the shoulders of those we stand on and ensure that Kentucky State University is around for another 135 years. On behalf of the Kentucky State University Board of Regents, welcome.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm State Representative Derek Graham, a proud graduate of Kentucky State University, and I'm here today to present a citation of achievement from the House of Representatives from the Commonwealth of Kentucky. And I'd like to have a few remarks to make before I make this presentation to the President. So to President Brown and Board Chair Dr. Elaine Ferris, members of the Board of Regents, faculty and staff, students, and honored guests. Thank you for so much for inviting me to help recognize the 135 years of greatness here at Kentucky State University. For more than 40 of those years, as I have said in the past, this university has been an invaluable part of my life. I have walked this campus as a student, as an alumnus, and as its legislative advocate. And I have had wonderful memories from all three of those eras. A lot of things have changed since 1886, of course, about Kentucky State University's commitment to scholarship and leadership that we have had. In its 13 and a half decades, it has charted new paths for this Commonwealth and for those of us blessed to have learned and worked here. This university has an outside influence that is growing with each passing year. The world is a better place because of those who came here to improve their own lives and the lives of others. I am proud to be one of these people. and I will always do my part to build on this university's many accomplishments. What I love most about this university is that it is both large and small. It is large in spirit, even if it is relatively small in size. And that combination makes for an outstanding learning environment, one where students and teachers alike truly know one another. Students aren't statistics here, and they never will be. It means a great deal to me that I have this chance today to pay tribute to this university that is my university and your university. And with that in mind, and as the school's state representative, I am proud to present a citation honoring Kentucky State for reaching this milestone anniversary. There is much more I could say today, but I want to keep my remarks brief, so I will end with this. What began with a handful of teachers and a small number of students has grown into something so much more than the sum of its parts. I wish our founders could see the results of what they started, and we must never forget that we are here today because of their vision. Our challenge is to do what they did to answer that same call. Let us pledge to help others. We will never see, much less know. May it be said that in 135 years from now, that we accomplish this goal, that we made life better for the generations who follow us. Thank you all again for giving me the chance to take part in today's ceremony. This is a moment that means a lot to me personally, and I am proud to help the university I love enjoy this special time. On behalf of the House of Representatives of the Commonwealth of Kentucky, this citation of achievement and the House of Representatives of the Commonwealth of Kentucky hereby recognizes and honors the student, faculty, staff, and administration of Kentucky State University. Dr. Brown, may I present this to you?
Congratulations. We'll get this together. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Angela Burchett. I am from the class of 2002 and Miss Kentucky State University 2000. Thank you. and thank you very much. And before I begin, I just wanted to thank the president, the Board of Regents, all the faculty, staff, current and alum, for inviting me here to celebrate for this most amazing occasion. I'm so happy to celebrate the 135th anniversary of our School on the Hill. Anytime I get a call to come back, I make sure I free up my schedule and figure it out so that I can be here. I'm trying not to get emotional because I'm seeing so many faces that I saw all the time here and stood in this very spot and sang for so many events and occasions. And I've been blessed and fortunate. I'm very grateful to have been able to travel the world and perform all over it and work with amazing folks and sing on amazing stages. But I have to tell you, nothing's better than being home. So thank you so much for the invitation, and long live Kentucky State University. But still I press on.
up in the skies, yet still I rise, never to give up, never to give in against all odds, yet still I rise, high above the clouds. At times I feel low, yet still I rise. And sometimes I'm troubled, but not in despair. Above all my eyes can see, knowing God is able to strengthen me, yet still I rise, never to give up, oh, never to give in. Yet still I need to know which way to go. Yet still I, at times I feel low. Yet still I rise.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My words on the occasion must start with my own background with Kentucky State University. I grew up in Hardin County, Kentucky, in a mining village. My father worked for United States Steel Coal Mine. And I'm proud to say that every teacher I had from the first grade through the 11th grade attended Kentucky State University. My first grade teacher, who taught me and my four older siblings, also taught our mother in 1930. I delivered newspapers, the Knoxville News Journal, to seven of my teachers while I was a student at Lynch Colored School. And my principal, Mr. John Vernon Coleman from Bardstown, would always say, "You're a little bit late today, aren't you, Billy?" And Mr. Coleman, when I got out of high school, said, when you go to Kentucky State University, I want you to go and meet Henry Vernon Cheney. He was my roommate. They went to Kentucky State College together. I didn't go to Kentucky State because my daddy wanted me to go to a community college in Cumberland so that we could fish together a couple more years. That was his thing. But I did get to meet Dr. Cheney, who inducted me into Phi Beta Sigma fraternity, which he and Mr. Coleman belong to right here on this campus. I want to thank Raymond Burse, who grabbed me by the arm as I was on an airplane in Raleigh one day in 1984 and said, I want you to come and be the Dean of Arts and Sciences at Kentucky State. Thank you very much, Raymond. And then on the timeline, I was standing out here with my friend Carl Smith. Dr. Smith and I were talking to James Juicy Glover on the football field a few years ago, and the president, President Brown called me over and said, we want you to help us do something at Kentucky State no matter what you do, and so I'm proud to be still affiliated with Kentucky State. The occasion, we're here to celebrate a history book, which we hope all of you will pick up. And I want to quote from Dr. John Henry Clark, Henrik Clark, a famous historian of Pan-African studies at Hunter College. He said, history is a clock that people use to tell the political time of day. History is also a compass that people use to find themselves on the map of human geography. History tells of people where they have been and what they have been, and history tells of people where they are and what they are. Most importantly, history tells of people where they must go and what they must be. And I think that speaks volumes to what we're trying to say today here at Kentucky State. All of us probably remember that great poem from Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, which says, the lives of great people all remind us we can make our lives more sublime, for in departing they leave behind them footprints in the sands of time. That's what our founders did at Kentucky State University. Thank you so much.
Dr. M. Christopher Brown II leads this institution based off four pillars of success: academics, access, agriculture, and athletics. I work in higher education because I believe in people and possibilities. And I believe in the students at Kentucky State University. They come here as they are, and they move onward, upward, and forward in life. Today, we'll have student reflections. Representing academics, Ms. Desiree Fields, a senior social work major. Representing access, Ms. Carly Mitchell, a senior nursing major. And Ms. Dominique Simmons, also a senior nursing major. Representing agriculture is Ms. Kaori Terry. She's a junior agricultural food science major. And Mr. Christian White, a freshman mass communication and journalism major, will represent athletics. They will be followed by another musical selection by Mrs. Angela Burchette, and resolutions by Mr. Richard Graves, who is the president of the Kentucky State University National Alumni Association and a member of the class of 1981. He will be followed by our mayor for the city of Frankfort, Mr. Lane Wickerson.
Good afternoon, everyone. May 18, 1886, my life's journey had already begun as this beautiful school on the hill was established. My HBCU, my Kentucky State, has been everything I needed when I didn't know I needed it. Historically black colleges and universities have played an important role in enriching lives of not only African Americans, but our entire country. I was born and raised in Indianapolis, Indiana. In high school, I knew that I wanted to go to a college where I was not considered the minority or join organizations to see people that looked like me. In the beginning of my senior year in high school, I had my heart set on attending Kentucky State University. It felt like home and that I was a member of the family. The institution welcomed me with open arms and everyone was kind. My mom and I knew that this could be my home away from home. HBCUs gave us the opportunity for academics when no one else would. Since my arrival on the Hill, I have grown immensely. As a student, I have learned more and my understanding has increased. I have, of course, became quite a social butterfly. However, more importantly, I am better and stronger as a Black woman. I am more compassionate and one that understands acceptance and diversity. In my short amount of time, I have gained confidence in confronting all things that stand in my way. In April of 2021, I was crowned the 92nd Miss Kentucky State University. That took courage, confidence, and support that I know Kentucky State helped to cultivate and develop. College days swiftly passed, and in a short year, I will enter the workforce as a social worker. Without a doubt, I will be prepared and proud because of Kentucky State University. Her history and her perseverance match the stories of her students, one of trials and victory. Let's celebrate the School on the Hill, the only public HBCU in the Commonwealth, in the home of the mighty Thoroughbreds, on her 135th year. Thank you, Kentucky State University.
Good afternoon. We all have a story to tell. I am a Kentucky State graduate, now a professor and a dean, and my journey started here at Kentucky State. Carly Aaliyah Mitchell, her journey began here. 18 years old, with no relatives or family friends that had ever attended college. But she graduated high school with honors and at the top of her class, with a dream of one day becoming a nurse. She did not know how, but one way or another, she was going to attend college, and staying in Owensboro, Kentucky to do so was not an option for her. Outside of a craving for a higher education, she had unexplainable love for dance. And this is how Kentucky State University made its way into her life and heart. One call to Miss Level, and I was ready to both apply for school and audition for the K-Ret dance team. This left me with another obstacle to overcome. How will I afford this? But like always, my alma mater came through for me, and like it has for so many others before and after me. My academic background provided me with opportunities for scholarships that met all my financial needs. My dreams had come true, and I was going to college, but not just any college, Kentucky State University. She was surrounded with her peers and educators that looked like her, like me, that liked the same things as she and that represented a culture. She was surrounded by Black excellence. Her alma mater has taught her to always be who she is, to always be comfortable in her own skin, and to set goals that, finally, that any goal one sets their mind to, they can obtain. My alma mater has inspired me to always give back to my community and strive for the highest. Because of Kentucky State University, Carly can proudly say I'm a first-generation college student who reached a lifelong goal of becoming a registered nurse. And for this, she is grateful for that little beautiful skill, School on the Hill. Dominique Nicole Simmons. After graduating from high school, I was not sure where or if I wanted to attend college. I attended Central State University for a semester. Early on, I knew that institution was not for me. I returned home to Detroit, Michigan, where I worked to keep myself busy, but in my heart, I knew I wanted to attend and complete college. I received a call from Ms. Level checking on me to see how life had unraveled after high school. She introduced Kentucky State University to me and everything the institution had to offer. So I enrolled, was accepted, and packed my bags. and made my way to Kentucky State University in Frankfort, Kentucky. This is one of the best decisions I ever made. I have met and made some deep connections with some of the professors and staff here, but because I did transfer from an out-of-state institution, I had financial aid issues. But because of the patience of the university and the compassion of the KSU Foundation, I was allowed to continue chasing my dreams. I was blessed by the foundation that truly cares about the students and wants them to be successful in life. I truly never knew how strong I really was until I came to Kentucky State. I have overcome so many obstacles as a student, and I have kept it pushing. A famous poet once said, "Stick to the fight when your hardest hits. It's when things seem worse that you must not quit." K-State is a big family, and I'm glad to say I never quit, and I'm a part of it.
With my soul, I had nowhere to turn, I had nowhere to go. Lost sight of my dream, thought it would be the end of me. I thought I'd never make it through, I had no hope to hold on to. I didn't know my own strength, and I crashed down, and I tumbled, but I did not crumble. I got through all the pain. I didn't know my own strength, survived my darkest hour. My faith kept me alive. I picked myself back up.
agriculture is the foundation of everyday eating. The distance of the healthy veggie in most neighborhoods are way too far to indulge. Yet my dream is to bring nutrition to neighborhoods that predominantly house African Americans and Hispanics. Agriculture seeks new realization to many who now wonder how far their food travels. Being an African American woman in the program strikes interest for advocacy to this matter of feeding the needy, I always say to the greedy. And we can also acknowledge our ecological footprint and other environmental issues that can occur to disrupt our daily lives in the office. I'm pleased to have taken this degree as it has brought me to the real nitty gritty of science. My perseverance to these issues raises hands to what our future will hold. Completing my own research has connected me very much so as well as recognizing the lack of diversity in agriculture. But being introduced to programs like Manners and the Black Farmers Conference, I've seen more people that look like me holding positions such as the secretary and the vice president of Manners. Excuse me, everybody, I'm sorry. I see my purpose is to educate the world on the importance of nutrition with growing. It is important to HBCUs because where diversity lacks, my interests increase. And that's why HBCUs are important to serve as a stepping stone to what the impossible didn't think was possible. Connecting with those of different accents and backgrounds and culture shocks my own passion to stay firm in the race. A thoroughbred is someone who has come a mighty long way, someone who wants to go upward from the bottom. KSU exists to invest in my greatness that I once saw as my own insecure. Continuing my degree here, I'd like to show future thoroughbreds the way to walk, the confidence to give, and the possibilities that comes in attending here. KSU people go out and serve as my duty in the workforce. I'm promising to pay it forward and feed the needy. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
There we go. Allow me to give you the definition and acronym, the universal definition and acronym of HBCU. HBCU stands for Historically Black Colleges and Universities. Primarily purpose to serve and educate the black community. Keep that in mind. Prior to my arrival at this HBCU, Kentucky State University, I was at another institution. And my mindset at the time, I was under the impression that I had this whole idea of college figured out. I had it down to a science. I had my T's crossed, my I's dotted. I was on my P's and Q's, right? And so when I had to transfer, I figured it would be as easy and as cool as flipping to the other side of the pillow. But it wasn't. And instead, I was twisting and turning in different directions and felt as if I was getting nowhere. But I was. And then I realized that in order for me to get to this second layer right here, I had to surround myself. In order for me to finish college, in order for me to make it, I had to surround myself with light pieces, pieces that forced me to twist and turn in different directions than what I was used to and comfortable with. Pieces that challenged my mental, right? Because when I came here, I didn't have any family, I didn't have any friends, and I was new to this environment, this campus, this culture. But eventually, I got that first layer and that second layer. And then all while I was twisting and turning in those uncomfortable and different directions, many nights, I wanted to give up. I wanted to quit. I wanted to transfer back home, and I wanted to cry. So guess what I did? Somebody say what? I cried. I didn't give up. But in the midst of my crying, one word came to my mind, and it's one word that we're tested on the most in school and in life, and that word was faith. And I'll let you guys in on a little secret. While I wanted to give up, I realized that faith without works is dead. Can I get an amen? There we go. But I also realized that faith without patience is childish. And I had to persevere and not quit, because just as soon as I wanted to quit, just as soon as I wanted to give up, I was almost there. I was at the top of my cube. I had one more year left in college. I have one more year left in college, excuse me. And I'm here. So currently, I'm here, and I'm starting to realize that all those nights I wanted to give up, I wanted to transfer back, all those nights I cried, the twisting and turning in a different direction, it was all worth it, you know? Because just as soon as you want to give up, you want to cry, you're at the end of your Rubik's Cube, and you would have been solved it. You would have been done it, and I'm doing it. And most importantly, I'm doing it at an HBCU. I'm doing it at Kentucky State University. I'm doing it at this institution. So allow me to give you my definition and my acronym of HBCU. HBCUs. It stands for Heritage Building a Character's Uniqueness. HBCUs are the essence of the Black community and culture. They are the foundation, the family and friends, the conquering fear. They are what molded this leader, this student, this scholar, this thoroughbred that you see before you today, Christian White. Thank you. God bless.
Wow, hard to follow that one. That young man said that. I'm gonna do one more song and I'll get out of your way. And I know we've been kind of sitting for a little while now, so this is the part where you can move around, clap your hands. I promise it's not a stuffy ballad. I'm gonna sing a little fun song, and this is what I'd like to call my ode to Kentucky State University, my love song, if you will. Go ahead, sing along if you know it. I think you know it.
Together forever through rain or whatever. Yeah, 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 yeah. You and me. So long as I'm living to love, I'll be getting
Thank you.
Good evening, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Langston Hughes, one of our great African-American poets, once wrote, "Hold on to your dreams, because dreams will die. Life is like a broken-winged bird that cannot fly." Proverbs in our Bible tells us that the people who are without vision will perish. And one thing that I'd like to say today is real quickly and brief is that the founders 135 years ago had a vision. And the vision did not perish. That vision today made believers out of all the doubting Thomases who doubted the very birth of this great institution. Yet today, here we stand. Undoubtedly one of the greatest historically black colleges in the nation. As your National Alumni Association president, it is my honor today to present a resolution from the National Alumni Association to Dr. Brown and Dr. Ferris of our commitment, a resolution of commitment to Kentucky State University. This resolution reads as follows, May the 18th, 2021. Whereas on May the 18th, 1886, the Kentucky legislature authorized the creation of Kentucky State University, chartered as the state normal school for colored persons, which was the second state-supported institution of higher learning in Kentucky. Whereas on October 11th, 1887, Kentucky State University opened with three teachers, 55 students, led by John Henry Jackson as his first president, later becoming a land-grant college in 1890. Whereas from 1902 to 1972, the school's name was changed six times from the State Normal School for Colored Persons to Kentucky Normal and Institutional for Colored Persons to Kentucky State Industrial for Colored Persons to Kentucky State College for Negroes to Kentucky State College, and finally, to Kentucky State University. Whereas in the spring of 1930, the KSU National Alumni Association was created and proposed a mission to promote the spirit of cooperation, preserve the university's values, tradition, and the heritage to support its mission and vision. Whereas the National Alumni Association is to be a global recognized alumni association that has a historically black college and university perspective, that is financially independent, and that uses its resource to promote the land grant status of all other programs and services of Kentucky State University. Whereas Kentucky State University's National Alumni Association established the Permanent Alumni Scholarship Pass Fund to support students, the association has raised money for the capital funding for the university and develop various foundation scholarships to enhance the education growth of students at Kentucky State University. Whereas Kentucky State University has prepared its alumni to go out and serve. Whereas we celebrate our alma mater, who provided a nurturing environment which enables our intellectual growth in a world that also created barriers which sometimes prohibit achievement. Therefore, be it resolved, the Executive Board of the Kentucky State National Alumni Association is and will always remain committed to the cause and the philosophy of Kentucky State University, and furthermore declares all alumni to celebrate and commemorate the 135th year of Kentucky State University. Respectfully submitted, Richard H. Grace, President of Kentucky State National Alumni. Dr. Brown.
Hello, everyone. My name is Lane Wilkerson, and I'm the mayor of the city of Frankfort. And I'm here today to proclaim today Kentucky State University Day. But before I begin, I want to thank Dr. Brown and the university, Dr. Ferris and the Board of Regents, and to the past presidents and distinguished alumni for allowing us to participate, the community, in your significant celebration. And before we begin, I want to point out some of the dignitaries that we have here in attendance. We have from the city, we have Mayor Pro Tem Katricia Waldridge. We have City Commissioners Kelly May, Lisa Unger, and virtually we have Kyle Thompson. We also have County Judge Executive Houston Wells, and Magistrates Michael Mueller, Marty Booth, and Sherry Sebastian. I hope I didn't leave anyone out there. And I know they will join me in saying that the City of Frankfort is proud to be the one and only home of Kentucky State University. And the City of Frankfort was founded in 1786, and just 100 years later, Kentucky State was founded as the State Normal School for Colored Persons. So the majority of our history has been shared with Kentucky State University. And we've been proud to see how the university has grown over the last 135 years, and I am more excited about what's to become over the next 135 years. So today, to whom all these presents shall come, whereas in 1886, the State Normal School for Colored Persons, established by an act of the Kentucky General Assembly, with Berea College alumnus John Henry Jackson elected as president, and whereas in 1887, constructed at a cost of $7,000, Recitation Hall, now named Jackson Hall, in honor of the school's first president, was the first and now oldest building on campus, and classes began there on October 11th with three teachers and 55 students enrolled. And whereas in 1952, the school's name is changed to Kentucky State College. And whereas, leading up to today, in 2017, M. Christopher Brown II becomes the school's 18th president. President Brown has set a bold agenda to move Kentucky State University forward, building its future on the four pillars of success: access, academics, agriculture, and athletics. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Lane Wilkerson, Mayor of the City of Frankfort and the Commonwealth of Kentucky, do hereby proclaim May 18, 2021 as Kentucky State University Day to recognize the 135th anniversary here in Frankfort, Kentucky. And I'll present this to President Brown, and congratulations, and together let us continue to move our city and our university onward, upward, and forward. Thank you.
Good afternoon. What a privilege it is to be here in Bradford Hall and Carl Smith Auditorium to see good friendly faces and people that are brought here today to celebrate this wonderful university. It is obviously my privilege to be here for a lot of reasons. One of those reasons, I had the opportunity to be the interim president during our 130th anniversary, and that indeed was a privilege. But to see KSU here now thriving is, in fact, for me, maybe the best privilege I could ever experience. As the head of higher education for Kentucky, I'm here to say that we're going to be here for at least 135 more years, and that makes me happy. It is also my privilege to be here to introduce what a wonderful group of folk that's on this panel, and the moderator and the author that I think you're really going to enjoy. The first person I'll introduce to you is my good friend Renee Shaw, who is the Director of Public Affairs and moderates the KET Public Affairs programming and content. She's also the moderator of KET Kentucky Tonight, Connections, Election Coverage, Legislative Updates, and all the forums at KET. In 2001, Shaw has been the producing force behind the KET legislative coverage that has been recognized by the Kentucky Associated Press and the National Education Telecommunications Association. She is an award winner and more awards than we have time to go over, but more than anything else, she is a stalwart of Kentucky, and I'm proud to call her my friend, Renee Shaw. Dr. John Hardin, who's the author of The Pursuit of Excellence. Dr. Hardin is from Louisville, Kentucky, and got degrees from Bellarmine, Fisk, and University of Michigan. In 1991, he joined the Department of History at Western Kentucky University as an associate professor, and later on was appointed assistant dean of WKU's Potter College. And then he went on to be an assistant to the provost for diversity enhancement. He has many publications, but Onward and Upward is one that I'm sure you know very well. So Dr. Hardin, good to have you here. Now the panelists, I'll first introduce your current president, Dr. M. Christopher Brown, who's your 18th president. And Dr. Brown has done many things since he's been at KSU, including creating the Atwood Institute on Race, Education, and the Democratic Ideal. He's also has done many things in his past, from being professor and dean at the College of Education at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas, before being appointed to University Professor Executive VP and Provost at the historic Fisk University. He also served as the 18th president of the nation's first historical black land-grant institution, Alcorn State. President Brown has also authored many publications, including 16 books and monographs. The other thing I will say about Dr. Brown, it's a privilege to work with him on a regular basis, and I am absolutely happy he's here as a part of this university. Dr. Brown. Good friend of mine that I've known for a long time, Raymond Burse, Esquire. He was your 12th and 17th president. He currently serves on the University of Louisville's Board of Trustees, and Dr. Burse has done a lot of things around this state, but one of the things he does the most is talk about the richness of his time here at KSU. And prior to his second presidency at KSU, Burse served as Vice President and General Counsel for the GE Appliances and Lighting Company from May 2002 until August 2012. Burse declined lots of offers when he was younger to play football to go on and attend Center College, where he was well known for his prowess in chemistry and mathematics. He also earned the coveted Rhodes Scholarship and spent 2 years at Oxford University. Dr. Burse, it's good to have you here. Another good friend of mine who I get the opportunity to talk with on a regular basis, and every chance I do, I learn something new and interesting from her. Dr. Mary Evans Sias, your 16th president. She's a nationally known leader and an advocate for students and higher education, and is involved in many community activities. She's a leader, as a matter of fact. Dr. Sias served as the president of KSU from 2004 to 2014. And as your university president, she brought a broad range of administrative experiences, as well as a valuable national insight and perspective to KSU that informed a lot of us in the way we do our work in the state. She's heavily involved in APLU and now serves at ASCU, is what we call it, and that's where I get the chance to talk with her on a regular basis. She is the director of the Millennial Leadership Initiative and assistant to the president of ASCU. So, Dr. Sias, please come out. Good to have you here. And now, Renee Shaw.
Well, Well, good afternoon. Thank you, Dr. Thompson, for that introduction, and it's a pleasure to be here in my green with one of my Link sisters in her green in this auspicious panel of presidents and the author of this book that I hope you will pick up, The Pursuit of Excellence. I read it last night, and I've even got it doggy-eared, which I don't think people do that anymore, but it is a very compelling book that traces the history of this fine institution for 135 years. So for the next 50 minutes or so, we're going to walk down memory lane quite a bit and get some recollections from this esteemed panel. But I want to begin first with Dr. John Hardin, who hails from my neck of the woods. I'm from Portland, Tennessee, and I'm a Western Kentucky University graduate two or three times over. And Dr. John Hardin has a legacy there, professor emeritus in history. And you are an author of many books, this being your latest and greatest, we will say. I want you to talk to us a little bit. We heard about the fact that there had been six name changes for what we now know as Kentucky State University. Can you walk through us very briefly that journey of the name changes and the significance it has for this institution to this day?
State Normal School for Colored Persons was the name of the institution simply to train people to teach. And that was the goal of the state at the particular time. This was the period where there was an absence of a state-supported venue to train. Next, of course, the Kentucky Normal and Industrial Institute for Colored Persons. They added one piece to that. They wanted not only to train individuals who were black to teach, but also to engage in skills and crafts. That was perhaps an interesting step. The next step, which I feel is really sort of interesting as it evolves, was from being to a state college. The Kentucky State Industrial College for Colored Persons was an interesting period. My parents attended here from 1927 to 1929, and at the time, this was the only place they could get a teaching certificate from a state institution, and so they took pride attending Kentucky State, graduating, and pursuing a career thereafter. One of the things that's very important for everyone to understand was Rufus Ballard Atwood. He was the man who made that industrial college into a state college. And during his tenure, he made that institution that was a simple industrial college training people to work into a liberal arts college. He kept it going and really kept it from being shut down by those who did not like that small college for colored persons. Next, after Kentucky State College, there are some name changes, Kentucky State College for Negroes, Kentucky State College eventually by itself. One thing I always like to point out, Kentucky State College was the institution that hired me early in 1972, late in 1972. When I started to work here, I went to work for Kentucky State University in July of 1972. Mm-hmm. That is the institution that everyone in this room should take some pride in. Mm-hmm. It is the institution that covers land grant, academic work, a worldwide commitment. So those are the different stages of the institution.
And as you mentioned, Dr. Hardin, who you mentioned your parents are alumni and your wife.
She's
an alum. So
a double alumni, along with, I've counted, eight others who graduated, attended, or in some way participated on this campus.
A wonderful legacy. And when we heard from those students about the four pillars of success, Ms. Desiree Fields, Ms. Carly Mitchell, Ms. Dominique Simmons, and Ms. Corey Terry, about the four pillars of success, Dr. Brown, I want to talk to you about that and ask you, because you wrote the foreword to this book, The Pursuit of Excellence, and you had written in the foreword that amid an overwhelmingly grim context in the fall of 2020, KSU enrolled its largest and most academically prepared prepared freshman class. At the dawn of the 135th anniversary, there was an energy bubbling at the college on the hill. And as you, being the 18th president, joined in 2017, the land grant mission of Venn's institution goes back to 1890, when that statute was applied to KSU. Why does that still have application and significance now?
Critically important. Thank you for being here.
Sure,
too,
my pleasure.
Michelle. As we reflect not just on the 135 years, this country has a scattered history on race, sometimes that we fail to acknowledge. And in this country, the Confederacy, which is no longer in existence, still tracks in what we call 19 southern and border states. And so in those 19 states, when they passed the first Morrill Act, and I graduated from University of Kentucky in Lexington, when they passed the first Morrill Act in 1862, it was intended that those federal funds would cover any citizen in the state to pursue an agriculture-based education, which included the mechanical arts, applied science, and military science, or ROTC. But 19 states refused to allow their citizens access to those institutions. And so because of that, they came with the second Morrill Act of 1890, which said that if a state did not provide access to all, they would have to take these funds and create a second institution that would be accessible to all. And so we see that with Clemson and South Carolina State. We see that with UT Knoxville and Tennessee State. We see that with Texas A&M and Prairie View A&M, and here in Kentucky with UK and Kentucky State. And so it was important because Kentucky State became the place where all citizens would have access to the same breadth of majors and focus that the University of Kentucky was providing, with a state-based concentration, not just on the liberal arts, but on the applied sciences and the cooperative extension, which says that this was, unlike the other six campuses that are public, this was a place that was supposed to take its knowledge cooperatively out into the community through land grant and extension. And so that mission is still strong today. Our land grant function, our ag function, is probably stronger than it's ever been.
Dr. Burse, you've had two tours of this university as president. The mission of HBCUs like Kentucky State University is to preserve African American culture and prepare its students, though, as Dr. John Hardin writes, for white-dominated mainstream of American life. And you think about those things and the fact that Kentucky State has become the most diverse HBCU in the nation. So I want you also to also give us some context for that movement to be diverse. And as you think about the legacy of John Henry Jackson in 1886, what do you think he would think of KSU right now?
That's a great question.
Well, you know, I think that his primary focus would be on, one, the institution is still here, still standing, still thriving, going forward. But I think you would be impressed that the mission in terms of educating citizens regardless of color is still strong and would be strong in terms of where we are. You know, when I arrived here in 1982, the common refrain with Kentucky State was, you know, black by day, white by night, mm-hmm. which was actually stated publicly in terms of where we were. And to see where the institution has gone over the years from that sort of designation, you know, to hear the mayor of Frankfort call Kentucky State Frankfort's University mm-hmm. represents a major mm-hmm. change and shift in terms of how this institution is perceived. But I think, you know, what to me the primary thing would be is that the academic quality of what Kentucky State produces and provides is no different than any others and superior to a lot.
Yeah. Dr. Mary Sias, good to have you home, second home, adopted home. And we were talking about, Dr. Burse was talking about the diversity of HBCUs. I'll just mention as a point of trivia that Dr. Hardin tells us in the book that Geraldine Ogden was the first white student enrolled in KSU. And since that time, the campus has become multiracial, multigenerational, multidimensional in composition and mission delivery. Black colleges, as John Hardin writes, are not a monolith. Can you give us a little bit more perspective on that black colleges are not a monolith and the value of being multigenerational, multidimensional, and multicultural?
Absolutely. It's good to see you too, Renee.
Thank you, ma'am.
When you think about an institution being very different and people think it's an HBCU, they're all the same. That's not true. The diversity here has always been a strength, I believe. When you get to a point where you can work, live, agree, disagree with each other, and find out that we can all live together, you are stronger as a community, you're stronger as an institution. When I arrived here, probably 50% of our student body was other than African American, but 58.9% of the faculty were other than African American. This place was a place where knowledge, research could thrive. And people now understand that as HBCUs, if you really want to get to students who understand what life is going to be about, who've lived and grown up in this diversity. You heard the students, we saw them.
Absolutely.
They were the best examples of what we can produce and what we can go on to grow in this nation. So Kentucky State was often frowned on unnecessarily. It was actually leading the way, and particularly in agriculture. Our aquaculture program was par none. Everywhere I went all over this country, I would be stopped in airports with people who knew about our agriculture, aquaculture, and pawpaws, which I never knew anything about before.
Okay, you're going to have to explain what that last part is.
Well, is Dr. Pompa in the audience somewhere? They're pointing back there. That fruit, they make wine out of it. They make a lot of things, but the one thing that we liked the most was the wine. And it was not a, it was not anything I heard of, but in Africa, other parts of the world, they knew about it, they could connect with it, they saw us, and people believed in this institution. People knew about Kentucky State, they knew about its graduates, and it became a place other people wanted to come. So what I can say to you, I spent a large part of my life working in majority schools, but I graduated from a historically black college. When it came time to make a decision about becoming a college president and where I wanted to go, I wanted to go, Ms. Calhoun, to an HBCU. That was my dream. HBCUs, mine was Tougaloo, prepared me to do everything in life that one could wish. We had the ability, and I wanted the ability, to give other students of color, other students who were majority students, international students, that same opportunity. And when you look at how many students are graduating today in STEM areas, when you look at this point, how many are leading countries, helping to lead countries, and I might add, are also sorority sisters and link sisters, HBCU has taken on a different meaning. This is our time. I think we're going to be able to expect some more funds because all through the history, and Dr. Hardin, you really pointed out, finances have been a problem.
Right.
And yet we thrive.
Right.
And yet we grew.
That's right.
And yet we go forth.
That's right. Onward and upward. And we see, Dr. Hardin, that there seems to be a federal commitment with this administration to HBCUs as well. And funding has always been an issue. And, you know, when you chronicle for us the challenges and also the successes of K-State, the era 1912, 1927 had its political obstacles. I think we can go throughout history and note times when state legislatures during the era of John Y. Brown, when they were looking more seriously at the future of K-State, wondering about the student enrollments that seemed to be from what even the office in the Department of Education had said was off skew, that there were too many black students, 20, 40-something percent as opposed to the 20% that was allowed. So there was a lot going on, and even in the 1980s, that could have threatened the future of Kentucky State University. And we've heard the conversation since then about evaluating what K-State should be. Can you tell us why it has always survived those challenges?
One of the reasons it's always survived has been simply a commitment by alumni and also the students and each generation of administrators. One of the challenges in understanding the history is that each administrator faced external forces that did not like the institution's existence. Mm-hmm. At one point, I counted, every decade there was a challenge to its existence. And it was up to each administrator, the president, the vice president, the faculty, and the students to say, no, we know what the institution provides. It serves a need. And so what they had to do was to gather resources, to push back. It was good that we heard of Derek Graham, mm-hmm. but before then you had to find friendly colleagues in state legislature and others who would come to Kentucky State's defense. And the good thing about it is we now have, at least in the legislature, of course, is Senator Neal. But the point is, each institution and each institutional leadership had to deal with this overarching belief that the institution shouldn't exist because it was the colored college on the hill. It's moved beyond that.
Right.
And I think the alumni, the students, the staff, everyone should be proud of the fact that when confronted with those challenges, they stood up and said, this is our place. Mm-hmm. This belongs to us. No matter what they say about the institution, we're going to defend it. If we don't defend it, who will? And those external forces will simply say, are you defending your institution? I lived through some of those periods on this campus. And we wondered, well, are we going to have lights? Are we going to exist? There was a faith that we are going to exist if we stood together and we did the best we could.
Dr. Brown, worthy of applause. Not just the words that were said, but the actions that made the applause worthy. Dr. Brown, I want to ask you, as you look at sometimes the political climate is tough and heated, and there's a lot of rhetoric about what is valuable when it comes to higher education, and even conversation about higher education itself, what it should look like. So as you think about what you are confronting now as the 18th president, what will you share with our audience about your strategy to make sure that it is understood by the governor and the state legislature and the city officials, the relevance of Kentucky State University?
I think that's a great question. The first is, one, our size and scope is unique. It is by design, not by accident. We've not celebrated it in the ways that we should, being comparative to others. Kentucky State is, by statute, the Commonwealth's public liberal arts college, mm-hmm. with a focus on access and the provision of the 1890 land grant mission. We've centered that and made that extremely clear in the legislature. I see, in addition to Representative Neal, I saw Representative George Brown from Lexington and others, that this is who we are, and that we're not ashamed of it. This is what we were founded to do, and that we're delivering on that mission. We add to that that Kentucky State University is a high-quality institution with high-quality students, mm-hmm. And that our students can compete and best. We won. I know everyone saw the movie The Great Debaters, and everybody wants to talk about that other college, but Kentucky State students won the Great Debate this year, 2021. It was, it was our students that won the IBM hackathon, with our students being offered jobs at IBM on the spot. And so our students are competing and besting in each and every category. And we've not put that out in front and in the center. The second is that the state must acknowledge that this nation made a social contract with the descendants of freed slaves after the Emancipation Proclamation that said in the Freedmen's Bureau that we would provide these institutions for higher education access, for access to the middle class, and that we would call them the historically black college. Mm-hmm. As I say to the Legislative Black Caucus and the General Assembly all the time, no public historically black college has ever been closed, and Kentucky State won't be the first.
Amen. Dr. Burse, I want to revisit part of some commentary that I lent a moment ago about John Y. Brown in 1980 and this Office of Civil Rights in the U.S. Department of Education looking at these what they considered universities, institutions that operated racially segregated colleges and universities. And you were on the Council of Higher Education, CHE they called it at the time, and you wrote the final proposal that was accepted, correct? That they called it the KSU problem, right? And you were the fixer to the quote-unquote KSU problem.
Let me put all of that in perspective for you. In 1981, the Interim Education Committee debated a resolution to close Kentucky State, and it failed on a tie vote, 1981. So when I came to Kentucky State, while I was on the council, we also received from the Office of Civil Rights a letter saying Kentucky had failed to desegregate its institutions of higher education. For those who are history people in the room, at that period of time was when there was what we call the Adams State litigation, which was U.S. federal government going after states for failing to desegregate the institution. Kentucky got a letter, and the Council on Public Higher Education was responsible for that. And the debate within the room was the solution is that if we get rid of Kentucky State, we don't have a problem, so we can get rid of the Adams State. Fortunately for several of us, you know, one of the people who did a yeoman's job during that period of time was State Senator George Davis Powers.
Right.
After the tied vote, Senator Powers went to a legislative conference and came back with a petition of 121 members of the 138 member General Assembly having signed it saying that they supported Kentucky State's existence. Mm-hmm. With that in hand, we were able within the council to persuade enough people to say, you know, we needed to enhance Kentucky State. So when you talk about the liberal arts mission and it being embedded in statute, all of that came out of that time period at that time. It was a battle. But again, it was, as I used to tell people on the campus, if you can count your money, you can enroll students, you can educate them, you can graduate them, you can take care of your buildings, you can keep your buildings clean, the next time they come, they have to tell you the real reason why they're coming.
Right. Dr. Burse, you were president during the centennial celebration, correct?
Yes, I was.
So you had, during that year-long celebration, I'm sure it was, Arthur Ashe, the Fifth Dimension members, Marilyn McCoo was always my favorite, actors John Forsythe and Diane Carroll
were
part of those celebrations. So can you walk down memory lane a little bit with us?
sing us down there.
I don't think I can sing. I can't carry a tune. You know, it was, having come in 1982 and pointing towards 86, which was the 100th anniversary of the founding of the institution, people on campus wanted something to celebrate. They wanted to showcase events. And we were fortunate enough with connections we had with individuals in Los Angeles to, in fact, engage all of those individuals to come to Kentucky State over the course of a year. So it wasn't all a one-time event. We had several events over the course of 1986. John Forsythe was here, Marilyn McCoo, Billy Davis was here, and Arthur Ashe was here. I mean, it was fantastic. It was a great celebration, great opportunity, and it gave us an opportunity to really begin to do something. Now, President Brown goes out and gets $1 million donations all at once. You know, it was during that time period for the first time we raised more than $1 million in the history of the institution. Oh, and wow. We used the centennial as the event to do it.
Yeah. Another good fundraiser was a successor of yours, Dr. Mary Sias, who came to Kentucky State University from the University of Texas, Dallas, where she had served as Vice President for Student External Affairs, but she had success in getting two $6 million capital campaigns for the YWCA in Dallas. So you knew how to raise some money. And talk to us about, because fundraising is always the big challenge for institutions, nonprofits, public institutions, and particularly those of higher education. So talk to us about that.
Fundraising really involves friend making. When you ask people for money, you want to understand what they really want to give to. And Kentucky State has some very compelling stories. And we weren't telling our story as well as we could. The alumni came forward, students were wonderful, because if you could take them and let them show people what they were gaining at this institution, it made life a lot easier. But it was clear, I had raised money, capital campaign money, I had done annual campaigns every year, that you need people behind you to do that. And we did have alumni behind us, and one of the best things that we did with staff here, before I even had my investiture, which was a year later, we raised $1,050,000 in scholarships during that very first year. People came forth and they gave. Mm-hmm. More importantly, we got what I would call strategic financing. There are some things that you might not know, and Dr. Hardin, you may not have even known either. Probably in the late 2008, it was the last time the Higher Education Act was really reauthorized, because we've gone through some attempts. I held it up. K-State held it up. I went to Senator McConnell, talked to him about the fact that he was a senator for all the people of Kentucky, and that Kentucky State really needed some money, some of the earmarked money. But in this case, I had read the enabling statutes about how you fund graduate science education. And the money was going to, not wrongly, but to all the HBCU medical schools. But the statute said graduate STEM education. And 80% of that in this country is at the master's level. So I got the data, we got people, I talked to Senator McConnell, and then we went to Ted Kennedy's office. They did their research and looked, and what we were doing, we really wanted to go under Title III. They didn't want to do that. It was held up, and they came back with an alternative, that they would create a new statute for us with most of the same things under Title III. So it meant we could use it for buildings, we could use it for scholarship, we could use it for equipment. That was almost $500,000 a year. Still, I mean, so when you start rolling it over, when we got the doctorate in nursing practice and when we looked at what we were doing in aquaculture and other science programs, where we got the money from was there. There were a lot of things that we were able to do because people opened the door. Kentucky State had gained stature, particularly because of the land grant programs, and people were willing to give larger sums of money. Not always a million, but $500,000, $480,000. Toyota stepped up, Alltech stepped up, a lot of places stepped up. When they saw the students we were producing, and when we were true to our words, and even legislators here who didn't want to talk when I first got here. And what I said to them is, give me a year. And then when I come back, if we've done what we said we would do, I expect your help. And to a person, we got it.
Yeah, there you go. That's worthy of applause. Dr. Burse, when you returned 2014, 2016, retired from GE, and there was some financial debt, 645 students hadn't paid tuition up to an amount of $7 million. They were informed to pay their debts, and you enforced some very strict financial controls. But you also got some national attention from the President of the United States, number 44, Barack Obama. And he applauded Dr. Burse for returning 25% of his salary to the university so that some KSU employees who earn less than $10.25 an hour could get a raise. Why did you make that decision?
Well, you know, first of all, when I knew that I was coming back to Kentucky State, the question was, there were improvements and chances of things that we wanted to do. How was I to get people on board? As everyone in this audience know, I am a very demanding individual. I like excellence.
I left that out of the intro, by the way.
I like getting things done. And one of the ways I thought to do that was to say to the people who were at the bottom of the heap in terms of salary and compensation that they were as important to this institution as the president is to the institution. And that represented my commitment to them, that I was willing to sacrifice and involve them.
So Dr. Brown, just in your few short years here already, you've addressed some student retention issues, established a university college. I want you to tell us about that. First class of Doctor of Nursing practice degrees were awarded by the university in the fall of 2017, first of its kind among HBCUs. And in 2018, the creation of the Center for Research and Eradication of Education Disparities, known as CREED. Dr. Turner just was an example of that as the interim there. So talk to us about what you're trying to build upon the previous presidents, two of whom are sitting with you today.
First, I'm not as seasoned as President Burse, so my checkbook is a little shorter. But what we did, and Kentucky State is proud of, we became, my first semester, we raised our minimum wage to $15 an hour.
Great.
And so we became the first institution in the Commonwealth for the $15 an hour minimum.
So I want you to repeat that again, because you were a little off mic.
We raised our minimum wage to $15 an hour.
Right.
And so
$15 an hour minimum wage for the people in the back.
Yes. Yeah, so our lowest paid workers were able to continue the progress
right.
made by President Burse. We have made a significant range of progress points over the last 4 years, which are highlighted in the quadrennial. But one of the most significant, President Sias will recall, when she brought on SAM, the student achievement metric, this campus had struggled in comparison. Across the Commonwealth, most campuses are about 40-45% graduation rate. UK, U of L, doesn't matter, they're about 40-45%. And Kentucky State had lagged significantly behind. And at our lowest point, we had gotten down to a 12% graduation rate.
Mm-hmm.
But this year, with a really hard-working staff, and in spite of COVID, our retention rate was 80%, and our graduation rate is 31%.
All right.
So we are tracking forward to hit those metrics that make us equal to every other public institution in the Commonwealth. We've got a lot of student success metrics. Our university college, we met today about new plans for student success service and expanding into TRIO. We've got two out of the three TRIOs, Upward Bound and mm-hmm. Student Support Services, but we're going to add Ronald McNair, Ron McNair program. So we're really excited about making sure all students have access to a quality academic experience when they go into the workplace. This is the bottom line for higher education. We're in the business of creating a product. Every student is a product. Faculty do research, teaching and support, ag does extension, but our number one product is the student. And we have to be sure that the students that we produce, one, represent our brand, that they are thoroughbreds, that they are pure bred, stable, fast, swift, and able to complete the race first, compared to everyone else. That's right, you can clap for thoroughbreds. And we want to make sure that people are proud of the product that they get from Kentucky State. I don't know if our new professional development person is in the office, Daryl Love, but the quality of the student is up. Both input and the faculty will tell you that. The input is better. That makes the output better. And now the demand for our students for internships and employment, we actually have more positions than we can actually place students in. And that's what we want to have.
Rufus Ballard Atwood, was he the longest serving president of Kentucky State University?
Yes.
So, and you've named an institute in his honor. Tell us about that.
Yeah. Well, and I'm surprised Hardin didn't say
and I want him to comment
to tag
well.
That piece. One of the reasons that Dr. Atwood was just a phenomenal individual, but his ability to transform the mission into practice came from his experiences at Fisk. Mm-hmm. Which is where you attended.
Yes.
And the understanding that the liberal arts are the root of all majors, but that you need to be able to apply whatever that major is into active work. And so, interestingly enough, at the time I was a graduate student at UK, attending Consolidated Baptist Church, we had a new junior preacher who had just gotten licensed. And that was Gerald Smith at the University of Kentucky. While I was working on my thesis, he was working on a book on this guy from Kentucky State named Rufus Ballard Atwood. And so one day he brought the book to church and gave it to me when it was finally finished. And so I began reading about President Atwood long before I'd ever even envisioned being employed here. And I think the work that he did in access, agriculture, athletics, and academics anchored this campus even to this day. That institute is designed to confront the problems, and we need it now more than ever before, of race and democracy in this country, and to understand that they are not competing values.
Right.
And that if we can have civil and instructive conversations, that we'll be able to get the most, not only out of this educational experience, but our society as a whole.
To you, Dr. Hardin, when you walk around this university, do you feel the spirit of President Atwood and what vestiges still reside of him today?
If you don't, there's something wrong. He created a family of faculty, students, and staff. One of the things that I had to do with studying about the history of the campus was give a sense of how Rufus Ballard Atwood kept every student involved in every activity. They had a number of activities, and you can still feel that. One of the things that in a sense taught me as a faculty member was Henry Ellis Cheney, who was here during President Atwood's tenure. And I got the sense that if you did not participate in every activity on this campus, then you weren't a part of being a thoroughbred. You had to participate in whether it was the Lyceum, student activities, the sports, the academics. You had literary clubs. So it was more than simply football. He left a legacy of academics. Even as a teacher here, I could see students involved in the gospel ensemble, in the athletic teams, all of these things combined to make Kentucky State a family. I'm losing a mic. The point is, Atwood created a sense of family for the thoroughbred community. When you enrolled, you simply didn't enroll for an education. You enrolled to become a better human being. From the day you started to the day you walked across the stage and received your diploma, it was just beginning. You took that experience and you went beyond. And that's the great thing about President Atwood. I regret I did not have a chance to interview him. I have watched a video that's on the website, which is excellent, that KET produced. If you get a chance, watch that. You get a sense of the man. He went from Hickman, and of course his father, Pomp Atwood, was active in education there. But he took his experiences from all of his background, and he wanted to convey that same experience from Fisk, his military experience. He wanted to convey that same sense of identity and growth on this campus. He succeeded. Mm-hmm. Kentucky State College was the roots for Kentucky State University.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that goes back to Rufus Ballard Atwood.
Yeah. Do you think we'll ever see a presidential tenure as long as his? And what are the reasons why that would be uncommon now, Dr. Hardin? And the others, I want you all to chime in on that.
Drink a drink.
Quickly, I've been told sometimes I talk too much. Today, it's very difficult for a person to stay as long as he did. He learned how to be, as Gerald Smith says, a racial and interracial diplomat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He had to deal with hostility. If you read some of his memoirs, there were certain members of the legislature who used a certain word, but he came back in a gentle way and proved them to be incorrect and got what he wanted. He learned how to navigate. Each one of these gentlemen, and President Sias as well, and I think if Dr. Smith was here as well,
yes,
you would have stories that would amaze all of us of what you had to go through to keep this institution growing, advancing, and Atwood was one of those who did that. You had to do that. We will never know all of the challenges that each one of you have done to keep this place a great institution and do it for the next, hopefully, your successors in the next 135 years.
Dr. Brown, did you get enough water to think about what you were going to say?
I'll certainly defer to the preceding president on my right. The great challenge for higher ed as a whole, and Dr. Sias knows that the tenures of presidents.
Yeah.
Are drastically reducing. There was a time that HBCUs were drastically lower than the PWIs, but now the predominantly white institutions are down to 4.5 years.
Yes.
And typical prison is 4.5 years, and for HBCU it's 3.8 years, so almost 4. So they're right around the same time. The challenge is the melding of the cultural dynamics. You're going to have faculty dynamics, staff dynamics, student dynamics, legislature, town gown, and alumni.
Uh-huh.
And to the extent that you're able to balance all of those around a strategic set of activities,
right.
The certainly my personal strategy is to try to keep people looking at the work and not looking at me.
Right.
So the longer I keep them looking at the work, the longer I can stay in the seat. But when they stop looking at the work and start looking at the person, then you know, life happens to all of us.
Right.
But I think here at Kentucky State, we've now come to a moment around a concentrated set of work around the four pillars. We don't all agree on everything. But I think we've learned how to at least disagree more quietly than we have historically. So our levels of dissent are much more civil.
Right.
And I think the dissents are not always bad. The dissents are other points of view. And so the challenges for us for when they have dissent, whether it's the legislature, whoever it is, to try to figure out a way to craft an opportunity to create something new to make that dissent move forward.
So there was a gaze between Dr. Burse and Dr. Sias about, the stories we could tell right now.
let me, in regards to your question about the presidential tenure, I guess the first time I was here, served on the NCAA council with a guy named Jack Dalton, who was president of McNeese State in Louisiana. He was a football coach that became president of a university, highly unusual. And they used to ask him the question, what was the difference between being a football coach and being president? He said, when you're a football coach, everybody wants you to win, but when you're president, nobody wants you to win.
Oh.
So.
That's true.
Is that a good analogy there, Dr. Sias?
Pretty much. Right now in this country, 70%, 75 actually, of all sitting college presidents, it's at public institutions, but at private ones, it's just a little bit less, will turn over. We are about a third of the way in. So in the next 5 years, 75% of the college presidents in this country will have turned over.
Wow.
Part of it is age.
Right.
I manage a program that trains senior higher education leaders who want to be college presidents. I've had 660 some people go through the program. We produced, as of last week, 10 more people became presidents, so it's now about 171. So, but what is changing is normally you would expect people who are provosts to go into those jobs. When you look in the audience, the closer you are to the presidency and the more you see, the more people are backing away.
Right. Yeah.
And it shouldn't be like that, but what that says is sometimes the cost that it takes on you individually or your family, if you have kids, they're looking at that. And so one of the things we've learned in the program is it helps people to decide also whether that's what they want to do.
Right.
As much as how do you get the job, and if you get the job, how can you keep the job?
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things we're doing is during that first year providing professional mentors who have been presidents, so when something comes up, you have a person to turn to that you can talk it through and understand. You all may be my associates, and some of you are now my friends, but when I was president, you were not my friend. The work has to get done, and the decisions are hard sometimes. They often seem unfair, but if you're gonna move forward, you have to do the work that's necessary. And I will tell you, one of the most important things is, I learned here, you have to see every person as an individual. Now, we work in masses of people, but what works for one doesn't work for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And until you learn that lesson, you're on a very fast road to destruction. There is no one way to do anything. Look at the people, look at the situation, and then come up with a solution that is germane to them.
Yeah.
And when you can do that, you can go almost anywhere and get the work done. And I think we've gotten a lot better here at Kentucky State. And the other thing that will make tenure of presidents longer is the governance. Presidents and board chairs and boards have to communicate and understand where the boundaries are on all sides. It is a marriage, essentially, and there should be no, it doesn't mean you can't disagree. But the disagreements, when you close that door and open it again, everybody has to be on the same page that the decision was made, this is how we're gonna move forward, because if you don't, you give other people things to pick at.
Right.
And if you pick at something long enough, it starts to chip away. And this is too important for us right now. We got a group, generations of students coming up behind us that are gonna have tough lives in terms of things facing them. We have to be prepared to strengthen them, to give them the ability to do well in internships, to lead in their communities, which is the other part of what we do here. Not just what they do on this campus, but what are they going to do in their communities? Did you all read that a city in Illinois, outside of Illinois, has the youngest mayor ever, and he's a Kentucky State graduate?
That's right, that's right.
And my nephew.
Oh.
And you, really, you're a nephew?
Yeah.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
And people were, it was all over social media, and it's exciting when you see that.
Yeah. A moment ago, Dr. Hardin brought up a name of someone that very beloved at this university, and that's Dr. Mary Levi Smith. And she was a link sister to Dr. Sias and I. Lost her in November. She's a 14th president. She also had previous experience serving as interim. I want you, because I want you all to describe your legacy, but I want you to talk about hers first. What does she leave behind? In absentia, can you speak? Can you channel her, Dr. Sias?
Actually, Dr. Smith is a cousin. And that wasn't something I said when we were here because it would, the only two women and you're related.
Sure. Yeah.
And actually, on my husband's side of the family, which is why they all showed up and brought people to Kentucky State University. I think Dr. Smith was the person who really focused on the academy, on the programs, but she never lost sight of the individual student. Those students would come with their problems and she was willing to see them. She also, because of her husband and his job, she was an avid athletic fan. She loved it. And she wanted to see all the student athletes achieve and achieve more, and she pushed hard. But as much as she accomplished, she did it with a soft hand. But if you weren't careful, that hand could smack you really hard because you needed to move in the right direction. Sometimes institutions have the right people at the right time. And Kentucky State has been fortunate in many ways. We don't always see it when we hear it. I didn't know it about Dr. Burse in terms of, until I read all the details in this book, that you started the demonstration farm and those things here. I got a chance to come along and put 90 more acres on that farm and build some buildings and build them out. All of us are like chains that are interconnected.
Right.
And we are stronger when we're all together than any one of us alone. And I can remember calling her and asking her when I got the job, could she tell me what to expect? And she laughed and said, the only thing you can ever expect at K-State is the unexpected. And she was right.
And she was right.
She was right.
So while we're wrapping things up, I'll start again with you, Dr. Sias, to give us how you reflect on your time, your 10 years at K-State, and what you believe are your biggest achievements.
This, I've had not a lot of jobs in my life because I tend to come and stay. And since I was here 10 and a half years, it shows that I liked it. This was probably the best job I ever had. When you're working 10, 12 hours a day, you don't always think that, and sometimes more. I had a wonderful husband who understood, but I still get, you know how long these text messages can get when the screens go away? Students writing, and they get your phone number, and they want to tell you what they're doing. The ones that you had, one of the best times here for me was when we started growing enrollment. And that year we had 300 more freshmen than we had planned for. And I got to get everyone who had a master's degree who was on staff and put them in the orientation classes. And I took one too. And we worked. And that was the time when all of us worked hard and really understood what our jobs were here. A lot of staff who complained about students coming in and talking stopped complaining once they got a chance to work up close and personal with them. One of the students I had in that class who was a straight A student but came to class with glitter eyeshadow on and those flannel pajama pants that we had to have a talk about. And what she was doing, she wanted people to pay attention. And I said, you know, you're smart, you're bright, and she was, because she went on to law school at the University of Louisville and finished on time and is in Atlanta working as a practicing attorney. And she remembers the stories that we tell, the things that we do, but she remembered coming that day and me sitting her down and saying, you don't ever know, we're the only university in the state capitol. At any given time, anybody can be here. You don't know whether it's gonna be the governor or it's gonna be a legislator or a person who can employ you. You dress always for the next job you want and not for getting up out of bed. I love this job because it was a land-grant institution. And I had to explain to people that agriculture isn't all about what they thought, the way you traditionally farm. The students that we got in that program, the difference that we could make, the purchase of the environmental center, they were all exciting things for me. One of the most exciting things, I got asked, and I'm sure you did, people would call and say, I know you all aren't accredited. And they were wrong. K-State has been continuously accredited. It's never not been accredited. And one of the most important things when I think about accomplishments really was not only getting accreditation when they moved to that 10-year accreditation, but being the president who was able to move us from a level 3 to a level 5 institution, which means that an institution with less than 3,000 students can offer PhDs. Mm-hmm. Do you know how rare and how important that is? I got a call when those first doctor and nursing people walked across the stage. Mm-hmm. It was important. It was really important to me that we do that, because that is a key that will be a way to open the door up for more money, more people, and it changed the lives of a lot of people here, because nursing is one of those professions where you can get 5- and 6-figure salaries, and if it's a doctor nursing, you can write your ticket anywhere. Yes. That was important. And there were a lot of people here, not in this audience, but in the Commonwealth, a lot of schools fought us. That was the last thing I was determined to do before I left. And my husband left before I did, because I needed to get that through. The other thing is the aquaculture vessel that we had that was Coast Guard certified, the Discovery Center. We forged a strong relationship with the Frankfurt community, the Department of Tourism, so that they could come up and they could use that boat, but with the elementary and the middle school students and our students, you could do the research on that boat, on the river, in sustainability and water qualities. I had fun because anything that I could imagine, it was possible to do here. It was exciting. I loved the choir. I loved traveling with them. And we were able, by working with our legislators, to get money. We built the new Young Hall. We renovated Hathaway Hall. Those seats you're sitting in that used to have coils sticking up, we were able to redo this auditorium and add new curtains. There was nobody that I could not bring here where I didn't feel proud of what we were doing and the quality of the students that we were producing. So, during the time with Dr. Burse and with you now, President Brown, there is a saying by a woman named Rosa Luxemburg, I think, who says, those who wear chains, until they move, they don't know they're chained. We have all started moving. Those chains started rattling. People saw us as people who were willing to put it all on the line and move this institution forth. I think all of us in our different way were committed that not on my watch will this institution go out of existence. That's not gonna happen. And as strong-willed as you were, I'm the highest type A that you can ever get. And I was determined that that was not gonna happen and that we would not only thrive, but we would succeed and it would be ongoing. And we would always have our heads high. Yeah. When you walked in and when people said, who are you? I'm a thoroughbred.
I'm a thoroughbred. Yeah.
And always will be.
So we're coming up on our time, but I want to give the 12th and 17th chain rattler a chance to talk about real quickly a couple of your proud moments here at KSU.
Well, I want to do two things, Renee. Is one is, you know, as much as a president may be able to accomplish, it is the people around them who execute and deliver.
That's right.
That makes all the difference in terms of that. You know, doing both of my terms, I've had an individual who gets little recognition and he likes to hide all the time. Mm-hmm. And that's Charles Lambert, who made a tremendous impact. Most folks do not understand or realize the stadium that sits over there is because of Chuck Lambert. The ASB mm-hmm. is because of Chuck Lambert.
Right.
I could go on to the other buildings. The renovation of several of the buildings on this campus was because of Chuck Lambert. Yep. And the extra money we were able to get during my first term here was because of Chuck Lambert. And he needs to be recognized for that. So that's number one. Number two, if you haven't figured out, you know, I'm not an individual who looks at what Raymond Burse had accomplished or did anything. People used to ask me the question when I came back the second time, why did you come back? And my answer was there are 2,300 reasons, and each one is a student. Mm-hmm. I like my legacy to be, hopefully in terms of the individuals who matriculated, graduated, and came out of this institution, who are making and having an impact in our society. One individual, I can remember a student from Detroit, in his junior year, we finally figured out he hadn't paid us a penny. And we were looking at financial aid, and his father wouldn't fill out the FAFSA form. Would not, mm-hmm. okay? And we made the decision that, yeah, we're gonna take care of him. We kept him here. We educated, we paid his bills. And he became a superintendent of a school district here in Kentucky. And it is that kind of legacy that I look at mm-hmm. and I reflect on. And it is what students who came through this institution while I was here have been able to accomplish and do in life.
Yeah, I want to give Dr. Brown the last word, but Dr. Hardin, the rich history of KSU, 135 years strong, how do you start off the next book?
I think the next book will need to look at the words from each of the presidents. Before this, I asked President Burse if he had some points. He has diaries. Mm-hmm. Those will be rich. Mm-hmm. Dr. Sias, you have some comments that at a certain point you need to share some of those untold stories to share with students and alumni and friends. All of that will go into the next 135 years. I'm an optimist. Yeah. I probably won't be here to see the next 135 years. But let's be honest, folks. If you want your university to remain strong, we have to listen to the wisdom of the elders.
That's right. Yeah.
And then build on that. So I'm hoping this little tiny book, which in a sense is an extension of the centennial history, will help the next generation to understand where we've been, where we are, and where we need to go.
Yeah.
So that's just my 5 cents.
And Dr. Brown, where do we need to go?
I'm gonna steal his mic because this, I think mine went dead. One, I wanna thank you for hosting. Thank all the presidents for coming.
My
Let
pleasure.
Me say, when we started planning this over a year ago and planned for this day and this moment, we invited Dr. Hardin to update our history. And it was our plan and intention to have all of the living presidents here today.
I too could not make it. We had all of our living interims here, but certainly during the midst of COVID, we lost President Mary Levi Smith. And I think it's important because this is my second presidency. And Dr. Sias, you probably knew me during my first presidency.
Yeah.
A lot more flash and bombast.
Sometimes it's good to calm down.
Yes, it is. It is. A lot of firecrackers. But I say that to say one of your early questions was lessons learned from President Smith. And that is that a successful presidency does not always mean the cosmopolitan work of the university, of taking the university out and being at every national meeting. My staff knows I've declined more boards probably than I ever have. I used to love going to the airport. But what Dr. Smith did was that she focused on being at home. And tending to the garden here in Frankfort. And I think that this moment at Kentucky State is a time where we are inward focused. And as President Burse said, we have a great faculty, great staff, great students, great alumni working to make home a wonderful place to be where other people want to come. And when I'm gone and I'm sitting on that side of the stage, I would hope that we will have been able to successfully modernize the traditions of the institution. And so we heard them talking about the lyceums or the centennial year. We call them assemblies now.
Right.
We keep them less than 50 minutes. And so once a month, we're doing what Dr. Atwood did, what President Smith did, but we're doing it differently. And we are trying to make sure our students are the best students that can be created, not just at any HBCU, but at any institution, anywhere, not only in the country, but in the world. They're thoroughbreds.
Yeah. Amen. Go thoroughbreds. Those are great words to end on. Give a round of applause to this wonderful panel. Thank you all for your service, not just to K-State, but this Commonwealth. And it's been a pleasure to share this stage with you all. Thank you. Thank you all. And now I'll turn the program back over to Ms. Clara Samuels.
We're going to ask our panelists to remain for 1 second, please. We want to thank everyone for coming today, but also want to thank some people that are in the audience with us. First, our regents, our board chair, Dr. Elaine Ferris, who is here. Roger Reynolds, Regent Reynolds, who is present, who is our only alum, who is on our board, and then also Regent Ron Banks. We can clap for them that are present. And from the city of Frankfort, our mayor, Mayor Wilkerson, is present. Our commissioners, Kelly May, Lisa Unger, and then our very own Patricia Waldridge, who is also an alum. If we can give them a hand, please. Any of our elected officials from Franklin County Fiscal Court, Kentucky Historical Society, Franklin County Trust for Historic Preservation, our Frankfort Tourism, and then Chamber of Commerce, if you are present, please stand so we can acknowledge you today as well. Thank you, and then also we see Representative George Brown and Representative Derek Graham, if you could stand so we can acknowledge you as well. And then for some awards today, I'm glad that our moderator is still up. If we can start, if President Brown, if you can join me to hand out some awards today. Ms. Renee Shaw, phenomenal moderator for today. We want to make sure we recognize her as well. Dr. Hardin, John A. Hardin, the author of Pursuit of Excellence. If you could please come forward, sir.
Oh, wait a minute.
moment. Now I understand. These are bookends.
Yes.
Oh, they go together. Tell me.
Oh, yes. Dr. Mary Sias, our 16th president, if you could please come forward. Mr. Raymond Burse, our 12th and 17th president, if you could come forward. Dr. Aaron Thompson, president at CPE, our Council on Post-Secondary Education, if you could please come forward. And then also Dr. William Turner, our interim director of the Creed Center, if you could please come forward. Judge Executive Houston Wells, if you could please stand so we can recognize you as well. Thank you, sir.
Thank you all for your patience. As we conclude the program, we will now have our 135th anniversary appeal by Mr. Michael DeCourcy, Executive Director of the Institutional Advancement. He will be followed by closing remarks by Dr. Donald W. Lyons, the class of 1968. And we will hear the beautiful voice of Ms. Angela Burchett again. She will be accompanied by Reverend Mario J. Rafford of the class of 2014, who's the senior pastor of Grove Point Church. Thank you.
Good afternoon. We're honored today to announce a special gift to Kentucky State University. I would ask at this time that our 16th president, Dr. Mary Sias, and our 18th president, Dr. M. Christopher Brown II, to join me here on stage. We proudly announce that Dr. Mary Sias has committed an additional $18,860 to the University Endowment for Student Scholarships. And we need Dr. Brown to stay. He's been giving out gifts. We got gifts for the students here. At this time, please join me in welcoming the Executive Vice President of the Park Community Credit Union, Mr. Dave Shadburn, for a special presentation. In honor of KSU's 135th anniversary, Park is committing an additional $18,860 to our Student Scholarship Fund. Park Community Credit Union is a proud supporter of Kentucky State University students through scholarships and student initiatives, and is the official credit union of our institution. Please thank them again and Dr. Sias for this incredible support. As we celebrate our 135th year of our great institution, we look back and say thank you for the near immeasurable support that has been given to this university by those who have come before us. From our first investments of $7,000 from this Commonwealth and $1,500 from the people of Frankfort, led by then Mayor Colonel E.H. Taylor Jr., to build what is now Jackson Hall and to purchase much of the land that is now Kentucky State University this side of Main Street. To our game-changing investment announced last month of $1 million from Diageo North America to establish scholarships for our most deserving students annually here on campus. We ask today for your support and investment in the future of Kentucky State University. We ask you to join us in honor of all who have come before us We ask you to join us in support of all of our students of today and the next 135 years here at Kentucky State. We ask for your time, we ask for your talent, and we humbly ask for your treasure to uplift our students. And together, we thoroughbreds will ensure the future of our Kentucky State University. Your gift of any amount today and throughout this campaign will benefit student scholarships and initiatives. For those who are able, who wish to ensure their impact into perpetuity, may establish their own endowed scholarship with a minimum gift of $18,860 over the course of this campaign. Make your impact today at www.kysu.edu/givenow. Use the campaign envelope for those of you in attendance here today, or for more ways to give or tax-wise investment opportunities into the future of Kentucky State, please email advancement@kysu.edu. We all believe in the future of Kentucky State University. We stand on the shoulders of giants, some of whom have been on the stage here today. Join us in ensuring the future of this historic institution and forever be onward, upward, and forward. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm not going to keep you long. I just want to advance a thought or two. Let me take this off to do that. As we assemble this afternoon, celebrating 135 years of our beloved Kentucky State University, I would like to start off by saying Kentucky State and other historically black colleges have contributed uniquely to the social development of black Americans. Concretely, these institutions have been the principal contributors to black literacy, the principal developers of a black professional class, the principal inspiration to black social organization, and promoters and guardians of African American culture. The single most important contribution of Kentucky State and similar colleges and universities has been the development of thousands of black teachers who transformed an enslaved people into a literate population in the space of 100 years. Of the total number of black Americans in this country in 1860, 4,441,000, only 5% were literate. Of this 5%, 3% of those, particularly, were folks who lived in the northeastern states. They were freed persons, all right? In 1900, the literacy rate had dropped to 44.5% of the total black population. By 1920, black illiteracy was down to 22.9%. In the 40 years between 1880 and 1920, black illiteracy was reduced by more than two-thirds. This achievement was accomplished under hostile conditions and in some cases, most discouraging circumstances. The story of the committed black teachers who fanned out from Kentucky State and other historically black colleges throughout the South, organizing schools and attacking illiteracy is the epic story of American educational development. It is this group of teachers that helped to institutionalize the then mandated and legislated system of segregated education in this nation. It has proven to be the most significant development for black Americans, both culturally and educationally. At this point, I'm gonna add a point of personal privilege. I'm of the age where I have, in my lifetime, persons who were slaves that were still living when I was young. I had a great-grandmother who was about 5 years old, she said, when slavery ended. She could tell us about going and getting the free papers down at Camp Nelson, all right? And she didn't pass until I was in junior high school. I think it was in the seventh grade. Mama Clark is what we called her. Could not read or write. She was illiterate. She raised my mother because my mother's mother had passed during childbirth of another child. So my mother had been taught at Russell School, which was named after President Green P. Russell, to read and do other things, of course. So she would read to her grandmother. They moved to town in Lexington in 1886 when they purchased property. And to this day, I maintain the property, and as a matter of fact, one of my items tomorrow is to cut the grass at 182 Eddy Street, purchased the same year that Kentucky State was founded. The oldest son of my great-grandmother became a brick and stonemason with the firm of Albert Byrd and Vertner Whitson Tandy. Now, some of you may know or have heard of Vertner Whitson Tandy. Brother Brown, I know you have. He was one of the founders of Alpha Phi Alpha fraternity from Lexington, studied architecture at Cornell. These guys, black, constructed the Fayette County Courthouse, the original courthouse on Main, and many of the original homes in the Chevy Chase subdivision. At some point, they left and went to Ohio because the work dried up. Two of her granddaughters graduated from the old Wilberforce University. Many people in Kentucky went to Wilberforce in Xenia, Springfield, etc., because at that time, Kentucky State didn't offer degrees. The degrees came into being with Mr. Atwood in 1929. Then seven of her great-grandchildren received degrees, with two of us coming from degrees coming from Kentucky State and one from the University of Kentucky in electrical engineering in the early 1950s. Now, my great-grandmother could not comprehend quite what had happened. She thought that my brother had gone down to Frankfurt. That's what people used to say. They even went down to Frankfurt. And my mother tried to tell them, no, he didn't go down to Frankfurt. He went to the university. And she said, what? The University of Kentucky? My grandson went and graduated from the University of Kentucky? And she was quite, you know, coming out of slavery, enthused. But she never could quite understand the engineering part. That was something we never were able to convey. She equated engineering with what? Trains, okay? But anyway, that's an example of what Kentucky State and many institutions have done firsthand. I know it. Now, Kentucky State was not alone in this Commonwealth in terms of educating folks and educating teachers. Of course, this was the state approach to education, which had been in development over a period of time. It should be noted that several private institutions were opened and operated by various groups. The General Association of Colored Baptists supported what they called then the State University of Kentucky, which later became Simmons University in Louisville, which had opened in 1879. This institution, believe it or not, had a law school and a medical school, as well as a normal department, normal being teacher training. In Lexington, we had the Chandler Normal School. It was operated out of the New England-based American Missionary Association and run by the Congregational Church. And the Chandler Normal College in Lexington operated until the 1920s, as a matter of fact. There were other private schools in the state that serviced and educated blacks. You had the Male and Female College in Hopkinsville. You had the Glasgow Normal and Theological School in, of course, Glasgow. You had the Danville Polytechnic Institute. You had a school called Atkinson College in Madisonville. You had the Fee Memorial Institute in Camp Nelson. You had Cadiz Normal and Theological School. You had the Simmons College in Bowling Green. You had a Pleasant Hill Seminary in Providence. You had a London Baptist Seminary. You had a Wayman Institute over here in Harrisburg, right down 127. Then you had a Eckstein Norton University in Bullitt County. And of course, the Lincoln Institute. And of course, Lincoln Institute was founded by the trustees of Berea College after they had expelled the black students due to the day law in 1903. And another aside, personally, by the time I got to high school, I had two teachers that had finished Berea College before they had expelled the blacks. Now, they were some old-timers, and some of them look at me now like I'm an old-timer. But my point is, they were still teaching coming out of Berea. In Louisville, the City Board of Education had its own, what they called the Louisville Normal School, to train teachers for the elementary schools for blacks in the city of Louisville. And in 1930, the University of Louisville did open up what they called the Municipal College after the blacks in the city had granted support for the expansion of the University of Louisville. And of course, that municipal ceased to exist in the early 1950s. And as another matter of information, all of the Greek fraternities, the Divine Nine, basically, at the University of Louisville, traced their charters back to the Municipal College at that point. Now, as I close, you might want to ask the question as to why would I talk about these other institutions? The answer to that question, if you raise it, is, as I stand here today and as I stood 5 years ago to the day, the question is, hopefully, in 15, 50, 60, 80, 100, or 135 years from now, that someone won't be standing somewhere or writing a report talking about enlisting Kentucky State with that other list of 15 to 16 schools that I just mentioned, okay? And again, as Dr. Hardin mentioned, and others, I've been around long enough that since a teenager, and now I'm closer to 80 than I am 70, that the word about merging Kentucky State or closing Kentucky State has not always popped up at some point, somewhere, by somebody. And an example, 5 years ago today, Mr. Burse was president. Within 2 weeks after that, we had an acting president, Candace Jackson. Within 3 weeks after that, we had an interim president, Aaron Thompson. And then 11 months later, we had M. Christopher Brown come as the 18th. So things change rapidly. If we go back and add 2 years to the cycle and make it 7 years, we'll throw in Dr. Sias, believe it or not. So a lot of personality changes, personnel changes in the front office, executive office, but Kentucky State has remained steady and on course. All right. As stated earlier, and in summary, KSU has been the principal contributor to black literacy, the principal developer of a black professional class, the principal inspiration to black social organization, and promoter and guardian of African American culture. The single most important contribution of Kentucky State is the development of thousands of black teachers and administrators who transformed and enslaved people into a literate population in the space of 100 years. The professional class that was developed by Kentucky State, the teachers, the coaches, the lawyers, the school principals, the ministers, the physicians, the dentists, the pharmacists, even the insurance executives, have served as a powerful inspiration to many. And at this point, I'll refer you, as I really close, to two scriptures, Colossians 3 and 15, the C part of that verse, and be ye thankful. And then 1 Thessalonians 5 and 18, the A part of that verse, be thankful in all circumstances. So today, we stand, we sit thankful for what Kentucky State has been and will be. Onward, open and forward. Thank you.
Thank you. We invite you to join us at the reception on the fourth floor of the Student Center. The brand new 135th anniversary Step and Repeat is there. There are free photographs. The photographer is there. And there's, I don't know what's at the reception because they've left me. But it's going to be a time to celebrate 135 years. I do not know if you watch, I'm off script, that's what I get to do. I don't know if you watch the Clark sisters on Lifetime, but I keep watching it over and over again. And so it's just a privilege for me to have Angela Burchett on campus again, and I'm hoping that she will be back with us for Founders Day and Homecoming weekend to sing for us again. Let's give her a round of applause as she comes with our alma mater. Please stand.
You got to come sing. Thank you. I guess that means I'll be back. Please raise your voices with us as we sing the alma mater. Shall be no other to
my heart.